everyone. Welcome to the UFPA Philosophy Lectures. I'm Emiliano Boccardi, and this is the first of a series of talks by Professor Andrea Idini about the foundations of quantum mechanics. Professor Idini is a nuclear physicist working at the University of Lund in Sweden, and is here today to give us an introductory overview of this intricate territory. Since when it was developed at the beginning of last century, quantum mechanics raised a number of interesting and perplexing philosophical issues. Let us welcome Andrea Idini. Hello, Andrea. How are you?
Hello. Hello. Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure.
Thank you for being with us.
I'm fine. Thank you.
And where are you at the moment?
Yeah, I'm just in my new place. I moved last week, so this week actually. So
okay.
That, interesting dynamics happening in this territory in Sweden.
I can imagine. Okay, what is quantum mechanics?
Okay, that's an interesting question. Already here, one can whip up several different answers. And so the answer that I like the best is that quantum mechanics is a general theory of information. So it's a way that we can write down a way to understand reality, to map reality, which is more complex and comprehensive than the usual way that physicists used to write physics in before the last century. So in a sense, it's a theory of probability where probabilities are actually probability amplitudes. And in real numbers that we define as probabilities, so if I have a classical coin, then I can flip it and I have 50% probability that it will land on head and 50% it will land on tail. In a more general sense, I can imagine a theory of probability where the probability is given by the square of another number, which is the amplitude, which is more in general, not a real number, but a complex number. So this is a little bit of technical answer, but this is the one that I like the most because makes you understand that quantum mechanics is not only about some physical thing that is happening, some test that on nature that we are trying to run and some experiments that we have to explain, but is truly a way to codify information and codify statistics in a more general way. Historically, experiment came first and then we had to explain those experiments, but one could imagine very well an alternative history where statisticians at a given point demanded that says, okay, what happens if probabilities were not real numbers, but were complex numbers? And what happens if I devise a theory of information, the theory of statistics based on these assumptions? And they would have reached exactly the same conclusion that we have with quantum mechanics that is used to explain the behavior of particles at a microscopic level. Mm-hmm. So philosophically, I like this answer more. So this
is. Okay, so can you tell us where it all began?
So where it all began, it began at the turn of the century, between the 19th and the 20th century, that scientists were investigating the nature of microscopic things. So what is the deepest, the nature of the deepest things that I can investigate with my instruments, that in that case were often electrons and electron beams. But so since the beginning of time, basically, of philosophy, people have asked themselves what is the ultimate nature of reality, what are the basic components that build us. So this was always a question in mind of the scientists. And the discussion between atomists that were believing that there was an atomic nature and that nature was made of little atoms and a lot of vacuum among them, and people that were actually believing in a continuum, so that the dense matter was actually dense and was populated by a dense and continuous state. So the discussion went on for a long, long time, for the whole history of philosophy, that then became natural philosophy and then became physics. And there were arguments on both sides, because it's not trivial to understand, for example, how light can propagate in a vacuum if there is vacuum between elements. I mean, if there is absolute vacuum, what's the medium where light propagates? So one thinks that light needs a medium. And so there were conceptual issues with this. And there were bullets fired from both sides. But at the turn of the 19th and 20th century, we had a very complete theory of light. So this was what really made the discussion different. We have finally made up the Maxwell equations, that were a basically complete theory of electromagnetic radiations, so of light, so we could really understand how light propagates on one side. And on the other side, we were getting more microscopic instruments that would go into the microscopic nature of reality. So, for example, we were using electromagnetic fields to direct electrons. And by combining these two tools, we were beginning to study what we discovered were atoms. So we were starting to have evidence of the fact that nature was indeed made of small particles that then we called atoms, and that these small particles live in what is mostly vacuum, and they have a nature which is in a sense radically different from what we are used to. So if we take planets, for example, the first thing that you can think of regarding an atom is that you have electrons and you have a nucleus in the center. This was not super clear at the beginning, but if you suppose that it's like this, and you make the first discoveries that is like this, and this was done by Rutherford at the very beginning of 20th century, so 1902, 1904, there were the first publication about the atomic nucleus. And therefore was discovered that matter was mostly concentrated in a very, very small place inside of what was becoming more and more clear being an electron cloud. So there was electrons that are very, very small, then we discovered that are basically point-like particles, and we still think that are point-like particles. And these electrons that are light and point-like surround a very, very small and dense nucleus. And the nucleus is large 10 to the minus 15 meters, so it's 1 millionth of a billionth of a meter. So it's really, really, really small, and it's 100 times smaller than the electron clouds around. So it's a very dense object that contains, in this very, very small volume, 98% of the mass of everything, you know? And therefore electrons were making a cloud around this very dense object that was called the nucleus. And if we imagine this kind of a model, like in a classical sense, then we are thinking of something like the solar system. So this is the famous planetary model of the atom. It was the first trial. And if you imagine this planetary model of the atom, then you have the electron that orbits around this very, very small center in the same way that the star is a very dense, very massive particle that is, however, really small compared to the size of the distances between planets. So if you imagine something like this, then you have electrons going around. And then you discover that, okay, but if these electrons go around, then they go around really, really a lot of time per second. And these atoms are there and are there since the beginning of time, basically. So why are aren't these electrons falling inside of the nucleus itself? So why are they keeping orbiting since the beginning of time? Because they are bound to lose some energy due to frictions and due to collisions with other atoms. And if that happens, then it means that these electrons should go inside in the same way that planets sooner or later will have to be, if we can imagine these planets going around forever and the vacuum of space not being completely vacuum, then we have to deduce that sooner or later the planets will fall down to the sun, to the center of the solar system, to the center of mass. So this was not happening. And then the scientists needed to find an explanation for this. So you had all of these things converging, a good theory of light, good instruments that finally were able to probe the inside of the atoms, the atomic nature, and the inside of atoms, electron beams, alpha particles, or radioactivity that was discovered and what could be used as a very, very powerful microscope, in a sense. And another thing is that by studying the nature of light and this Maxwell equation, Einstein, only by a one could say a stroke of genius, but very young, and only with the power of his own imagination and intuition, he managed to understand something about the nature of light that was really important into tying into all of these pictures. So that he discovered that light behaves, of course, as wave, as described by the Maxwell equation, and has a certain wave with a certain frequency. The thing he discovered is twice. Once is that the speed by which this wave propagates in the vacuum is always the same. So it does not obey to Galilean relativity. So if I throw a ball when I'm on top of a train, the ball will take the velocity of my throwing and the velocity of the train. So this is a very basic concept in mechanics, in physics. But with the light, does not work that way. If the train shed is blinks is its light, or if a car blinks the headlights, what happens is that the light will move away from the car at exactly the same speed as a person turning on and off a torch. So this was understanding of Maxwell equation and these fundamental results inside of the Maxwell equation made Einstein formulate the theory of special relativity. And another result is that if you consider this happening, so the fact that the light moves always at this very fundamental velocity, if you consider these as your basic building block, what happens is that light can have a frequency. And this frequency can be very, very long, or like in the radio waves, or in colors like red, as a longer frequency than blue light. So what it means is that if light moves at exactly the same velocity, and then the blue light, it's like this. It moves, has to move at the same velocity as a shorter wavelength, so it has to move quickly up and down, in a sense. It has to oscillate very, very quickly. While the red light, it has a longer wavelength, moves at exactly the same speed, but has to oscillate with a longer wavelength. So it will not move up and down quickly, it will move up and down very slowly. So there is a direct relation between the wavelength, so the color, and the energy of this wave of light. And this direct relation is also observed in some experimental condition to correspond to the energy that a single, what will be called then, quantum of light has. So if you shone a beam of light onto a plate, a metal plate, and if you shone a red light, then nothing happens on the plate. The light gets reflected and you see it back. And if you show a blue light on the same plate, what happens is that electrons are taken outside of the metal, and the electrons start going around. And if you close a circuit, like an electrical circuit, and if you close it, then you will see a current going through it. So this can happen only because these light, which has more energy, the blue light has more energy, but it's not the total amount of energy that you are shining through, because otherwise it would just take a stronger red light. The stronger red light has more energy than a weak blue light, let's say. But it's the amount of a single wave packet that is giving us a kick to these electrons and making them going around in the circuit. So this testifies to the nature of light, which is both a wave, because it is described by these Maxwell equations, and these Maxwell equations are wave equations. So this was deduced, exactly this conceptual framework was deduced by means of wave mechanics. But it's also a particle, because you need a particle that arrives with a given energy and gives a kick to another particle that you know, that is the electron. So you have this dual nature of light that was discovered. So all of these together, the fact that you have dual nature of light, the fact that you start to see these electrons, and you have to explain why the electrons are not falling down the nucleus, the fact that you start to probe the nature of atoms and the possible excitation of atoms. Actually, this was one of the first formulation of quantum mechanics were done really here in Lund, and was by a guy named Rydberg. That was the first Nobel Prize, I think. And it was here in Lund. So at the department where I work. So this is a bit of an historical note. And so you have all of these coming together, and this made clear that there was the need for a different formulation of the roles of nature, in a sense, of the fundamental roles on how microscopic matter behaves, that is radically different from how a pencil moves or you and me are moving our hands around, and so the whole theory of kinematics, kinetic, and the whole theory of macroscopic object that was done in physics. So there was the need for this new theory. So this is how historically this all started, and what are the important physics fingerprints of the historically making it, having the need for developing something new. So I hope I answered your question in a little bit long-winded way.